When a tornado or a flood is impending, people are given a warning. And if you listen and obey the warning, you can escape the destruction coming. In the same way, the Bible gives a warning about a disaster that is yet in the future. And if you will follow the warning, you will escape the trouble that is going to come on everyone else. Stay tuned and we'll see exactly what this final warning is.
Welcome to Steps to Life with Dr. John Grossball. Bible prophecy tells us that we are living in the last days of this earth's history before Jesus' second coming. Today's program will help you prepare for these coming events. Stay tuned.
Thanks for joining us. In just a moment, we're going to look at a warning in the Bible about a coming disaster and how you can avoid it. But before we do that, let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to read from His holy book. Father in heaven, we thank you for Bible prophecy. We thank you for the information that it shows us about the future and how to get ready for it. And we pray that you will help us now by your Spirit to understand what we read and to be able to apply it to our own life. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Today's free book is entitled Armageddon. To receive your copy, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer ARM. What is Armageddon? Where will it take place? Who will be involved? These are questions that many people have, but do not know the answers. To receive your copy of Armageddon, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer ARM. And now, Pastor John Grossball.
In Old Testament times, over 2,500 years ago, the Bible contains prophecies concerning what would happen in this world in the very last period of time of Earth's history. For example, here is one from the book of Joel, the third chapter. It says, starting in verse 12, "Let the nations be wakened and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat, for there I will sit to judge all the surrounding nations. Put in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. Come, go down, for the winepress is full, the vats overflow, for their wickedness is great. Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision, for the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision." So here we see that in the closing period of Earth's history, it says the wickedness in the world would be great. Actually, this is something that is repeated over and over again in Bible prophecy in both the Old and New Testament, that as we approach the end of Earth's history, the wickedness in the world would become exceedingly great. Here's another one from the prophet Isaiah. In Isaiah 24, it says, "The earth is violently broken. The earth is split open. The earth is shaken exceedingly. The earth shall reel to and fro like a drunkard and shall totter like a hut. Its transgression shall be heavy upon it, and it will fall and not rise again." So you see the same thing again. It says here, the transgression, the sin, the evil, the iniquity will be heavy upon it. In the New Testament, we have these same types of warnings repeated over and over again. Notice what Jesus said about the last days in Matthew 24. Matthew 24. He says, "Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. And because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold, but he who endures to the end shall be saved." Notice what Jesus said. Jesus said that in the last days, that the lawlessness would abound all over the earth. Now, what is lawlessness? Breaking the law. The Bible says that sin is lawlessness. Sin is the transgression of the law. You can read it in your Bible in 1 John 3:4. So sin, lawlessness, evil, iniquity would abound all over the world in the last days. That's what the Bible says. We read two texts already from the Old Testament. We read from the words of Jesus. The Apostle Peter and the Apostle Paul say the same thing. So does the Apostle John. Notice what the Apostle Paul says about it in 2 Timothy, the 3rd chapter. The Apostle Paul is talking about the last days. And he says, "But know this, that in the last days perilous times will come. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying its power, and from such people turn away." And then he says in a later verse in the same chapter, 2 Timothy 3, he says, "Evil men and imposters will grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived." Well, what is going to be the end of these things? The Bible says over and over again that when Jesus comes again, He's coming to judge the world. When Jesus came and was born in Bethlehem, when He came the first time, the first advent of Christ, He came to save the world. He said to Nicodemus that He had not come, that was at His first coming, He had not come to judge the world, but to save the world. But when He comes the second time, the plan of salvation will be over. You'll either already be saved or you'll be lost. The Bible states this very, very clearly in Revelation 22. Notice what it says in Revelation 22, 11 and 12. It says, "He who is unjust, let him be unjust still. He who is filthy, let him be filthy still. He who is righteous, let him be righteous still. He who is holy, let him be holy still. And behold, I am coming quickly, and my reward is with me to give to everyone according to his work." Notice this pronouncement that you're going to stay in the situation you're in. You're going to stay in the moral condition that you're in, whether you are righteous or evil, holy or wicked. You're going to stay that way. Why? Because the only way that you can change from being a wicked person to a righteous person is if you accept the pleading of the Holy Spirit in your heart, in your life. And if the Holy Spirit is removed, then it was impossible for you to repent. And the Bible says very clearly that God's Spirit does not strive with men always. It is possible for a human being, a group of human beings, or for the whole human race to commit the unpardonable sin so that the Holy Spirit withdraws and allows people to go in the way that they have chosen. Now, the Bible predicts that because of the increase of wickedness and lawlessness in the world, that in the last days, God is going to send a final warning. Why is it necessary for God to send a final warning? Because of the state of wickedness that this world is going to come to, it is going to be necessary for God to stop it. And so we read about the final warning in Revelation, the book of Revelation, the latter part of the book of Revelation. We see the height of wickedness that this world is going to get into in Revelation, the 13th chapter. It says there in Revelation 13, it says, "He deceives those who dwell on the earth by those signs which he was granted to do in the sight of the beast, telling those who dwell on the earth to make an image to the beast who was wounded by the sword and lived. He was granted power to give breath to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast to be killed. And he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their foreheads, and that no one may buy or sell except one who has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name." Notice, You're going to be commanded to worship an image. Now, image worship is forbidden in the second commandment. The second commandment is the second longest commandment in the Ten Commandments. And image worship is forbidden, but you're going to be commanded to worship this image. And if you do not commit that idolatry, you will not be able to buy and sell. And eventually, as we read in verse 15, there will be a decree that you are to be put to death. Well, somebody says, if that's the way it is, if the only way I can survive, if the only way I can buy and sell, if the only way I can eat is to worship an image, I'll just have to do it. That's what most people thought on the plain of Dura when Nebuchadnezzar put up an image. You can read about that in Daniel, the third chapter. He put up an image and said, when you hear the sound of music, you fall down and worship this image. And if you don't worship this image, you're going to be cast into a burning fiery furnace. The same way this image to the beast that is set up, if you don't worship it, you will be forbidden to buy or sell. You won't be able to buy or sell, and it will finally be declared that you are going to be put to death. Now, when things get to this kind of an impasse, the Bible says that God is going to give a final warning to the people that are enforcing this mark of the beast and enforcing the worship of the image of the beast. And here's the final warning that God is going to give them. It's recorded in Revelation 14, 6 to 12. We will just read right now verses 9 to 11. It says, then a third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if anyone worships the beast and his image and receives his mark on his forehead or on his hand, he himself shall also drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out full strength into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascends forever and ever, and they have no rest day or night, who worship the beast and his image, and whoever receives the mark of his name. My friends, this is the most fearful threatening that you will find anywhere throughout the entire Bible. The third angel's message in Revelation 14, 9 to 12. The people that are worshiping the image, of course, are breaking the Ten Commandments because the Ten Commandments forbid the worship of images in Second Commandment. They're also, of course, breaking the First Commandment, which says, you shall not have any other gods before me. So these people are breaking the law of God. That's what's involved in this worshiping of the image, receiving the mark. What about the people that won't worship the image? The people that won't receive the mark? The people that refuse to receive the mark? The people that won't take the name of the beast or receive the mark of the beast or the number of his name, or then they won't worship the image? What about them? They're described in the third angel's message too in verse 12. Notice how they're described. It says, here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Notice the contrast that is drawn in this passage of Scripture. On the one hand, you have people that are worshiping the image to the beast, and they are threatened with eternal destruction in hellfire. And then on the other hand, you have another group called the holy people, and who are they? They're the ones that keep God's commandments. They're the ones that are not engaged in lawlessness. They're the ones that refuse to break God's law. You have these two groups pointed out. Now, as an introduction to the third angel's message, you have a warning against false worship. The issue at the end of the world is going to be worship. You see, if you're worshiping the image of the beast, you're engaging in false worship that God will not accept. And so, there's a warning against false worship as an introduction to the third angel's message. In Revelation 14:8, the second angel's message reads like this. It said, and another angel followed, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she has made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. This message forms a part of the final warning that is going to be given to this world because of the increase in wickedness. Stay tuned and we'll see exactly how that final warning is worded.
Sometimes studying the Bible on your own without any help or a guideline to follow can be a little difficult. And after confusion and frustration set in, we all too often turn to other things. If this sounds like you, you're not alone. The Steps to Life Bible Correspondence School is just the answer. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for your free Bible Correspondence Starter Pack.
I really enjoyed being able to study at home. I'm a new Christian and I definitely knew I needed some guidance.
Simply review each lesson and answer the questions.
These studies were great. It just seemed like the Bible opened up for me.
Then send the completed lesson back to us in the envelope provided.
These studies were very professional. They didn't take a lot of time, and I really appreciated that.
A Bible teacher will then look over each lesson and send them back to you with the next set of studies. It's that simple and totally free. Call Steps to Life Television at 1-800-THE-TRUTH.
I'm so glad I called.
Welcome back. Much of Bible prophecy has already been fulfilled. We can read throughout the Bible and see prophecy after prophecy, predictions about the future that have already been fulfilled. But we're going to read now about a prophecy that as of this time has not been fulfilled yet, but it is going to be fulfilled and it could be fulfilled in the very near future. This prophecy is a final warning that it will be given concerning wickedness in this world. And here is the way it reads in Revelation, the 18th chapter. It says, "After these things I saw another angel coming down from heaven, having great authority, and the earth was illuminated with his glory. And he cried mightily with a loud voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become a habitation of demons, a prison for every foul spirit, and a cage for every unclean and hated bird. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, Come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins, and lest you receive of her plagues." This scripture points forward to a time when the announcement of the fall of Babylon, as made by the second angel in Revelation 14:8, is to be repeated with the additional mentions of corruptions which have been entering the various organizations that constitute Babylon since that message was first given in the 19th century. A terrible condition of the religious world is here described. With every rejection of truth, the minds of people become darker and their hearts become more hardened until they become just the same as infidels, although they call themselves Christians. And in defiance of the warnings that God has given, they continue to trample on one of the precepts of the Decalogue, the Ten Commandments, until the time comes when they are willing to persecute those who are determined to keep all of the law of God. Not only is Christ set at naught in the contempt placed upon His word and His law and His people, but also as the teachings of spiritualism come to be accepted in the religious world, which we see happening today, the restraint imposed upon the carnal mind then is removed. And a belief in these spiritual manifestations opens the door to seducing spirits and doctrines of demons. And so the influence of evil angels is felt in the religious world. Of Babylon at the time that this prophecy is given, it is declared, her sins have reached to heaven, and God has remembered her iniquities. That's Revelation 18, verse 5. In other words, she has filled up the measure of her guilt, and destruction is about to come upon her. But God still has people in Babylon. And before the visitation of his judgments on mystical Babylon, these faithful ones must be called out so that they do not partake of her sins and receive of her plagues. Notice what it says again in Revelation 18, verse 4. It says, "And I heard another voice from heaven saying, Come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins, and lest you receive of her plagues." If you stay with a group of people who are deliberately breaking God's law by staying with them, by giving your time, your money, and your influence to them, you are breaking God's law too. You are giving your influence, your time and money to wickedness. And so, you will have to separate yourselves. You'll have to extricate yourself. The Bible says, come out so that you don't participate in her sins. Because if you share in her sins, remember what sin is? Sin is transgressing God's law, 1 John 3, 4. If you participate with a group in sin, you will also participate with that same group in the plagues of God that are going to be poured out on sinners in the last day. Those plagues are described in Revelation, the 16th chapter. The Bible says, clear back in New Testament times, Christians were given the warning to separate from that which was unclean. Notice what it says in 2 Corinthians 6, verses 14 to 18. It says, "Do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Belial? Or what part has a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God, as God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord God Almighty." It is actually, when you think through these announcements, this final warning that is to be given to the inhabitants of the earth, and study this out, you realize that it is a fearful issue to which the world is to be brought. The powers of earth will be united together to war against the commandments of God, as we just read in Revelation 13, 15 to 17. They will decree, as we just read, that all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, will receive a mark or worship the beast, as you can read in those verses, Revelation 13, 15 to 17. In other words, you will either have to obey these laws, which involve breaking the Ten Commandments, or else if you refuse compliance, you will be visited with, first of all, civil penalties, and finally with criminal penalties. You will be declared worthy or deserving of death. But on the other hand, the law of God demands obedience and threatens wrath against those who disobey its precepts. And so the issue is going to be at the end of the world, who are you going to obey? When the issue is thus clearly brought before the people of this world, anyone who tramples upon the law of God in order to obey a human law will receive the mark of the beast. But those who accept the sign of allegiance to God's authority and choose to obey God, to keep the Ten Commandments and not violate them, those will receive the seal of God and be saved from the destruction, the seven last plagues that are coming. The warning from heaven is, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. But no one is made to suffer the wrath of God until the truth has been brought home to his mind and conscience and has been rejected. There are people today who have never had opportunity to hear the special truths of Bible prophecy for the last days. And the obligation of keeping all of the commandments of God, they have not understood. But when the great test is brought and people understand what the issues are, what is at stake, everyone in the world will have to make up his or her mind. Am I going to obey the commandments of God, or am I going to obey the commandments of men? Which am I going to do? Now, before this time, people who have proclaimed the third angel's message have often been regarded as alarmists. Especially was this so in the 19th century. Their predictions that the time would come when there would be religious intolerance in the United States, that the church and the state would unite to persecute those who keep all the commandments of God, has been pronounced groundless and absurd. It has been confidently declared that this land could never be other than what it always was, the defender of religious freedom. But as we draw near the end of the world, there will be strange developments as the Spirit of God is withdrawn from our world. Some are given inducements to renounce their faith, but their steadfast answer is, show us from the Word of God our error. Remember, Jesus said to the devil, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds from the mouth of God. People in past ages had to make this same decision. Am I going to obey the Word of God even if the state doesn't agree? Or am I going to obey the Word of man and violate the Word of God? That's the decision that had to have been made over and over again in the past. And that's a decision that everybody in the world will have to make as we approach the end of the world. Who am I going to obey? Am I going to obey the commandments of God? Or am I going to violate the commandments of God to obey the commandments of men? That is a decision, friend, that everybody in the world, you and I, we will all have to make. Thank you for joining us for today's program. Locally and worldwide, people are blessed by our offers of free Bible studies and free booklets because of your support. Our ministry is funded by God's children. If the Holy Spirit impresses you to send a gift to Steps to Life, you can send to Steps to Life, Post Office Box 782828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. Or you can donate by calling our 800 number, 1-800-THE-TRUTH, or by visiting our website.
We hope you've enjoyed today's program. Today's free book is entitled Armageddon. To receive your copy, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer ARM. What is Armageddon? Where will it take place? Who will be involved with it? Who will survive it? And what will be the end result? These are questions that many people have but do not know the answers. To find the answers, we need to look at and compare the scriptures to see what they teach about this very important subject. To receive your free copy of Armageddon, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer ARM. From all of us here at Steps to Life Ministries, may God richly bless you as you seek for His truth.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. Steps to Life is supported by your donations. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org. And our web address is www.stepstolife.org.